My name is Dave Perlick.
And I'm Jillian Perlick.
Together we've been operating Regent Kitchen and Bar for the past 2 years. The last few days in March that we were able to operate, we were cautiously optimistic that we would continue to serve, but then there was a notice that all restaurants and bars and other food service establishments would be closed down, and honestly, it was shocking. We didn't know that we were gonna open back up within the near future, maybe a couple weeks, maybe a month. We might be shut down entirely.
It just felt like everything we worked so hard for had just been ripped out from underneath us.
Every morning, my wife and I would sit and talk, just trying to put the right pieces in place to serve our community, to serve our employees.
We just thought we'll take the couple carryout orders, and we found ourselves drowning and the phones ringing. And we thought, oh my goodness, we're gonna have to bring in staff and provide, this is great. We can provide to-go meals, and we figured it out, fine dining style.
We've been at Harvest for 12 years now, so we've been able to meet and befriend many people. And the Small Business Directory definitely led a lot of local church members to come and dine at our establishment.
Even the amount of emails and text messages we got of just, how are you guys doing? And we're just like, you know, thanks for reaching out. Even that in itself was nice. You know, people were thinking about us, and you know, somebody from the church even sent in just a monetary gift for us, just for us. And we felt at that point, we said, oh my gosh, that was so great, but we're doing okay. So we actually took that money and brought food to the Harvest food drive. We were also presented with providing meals for hospital staff. Lauren Hills from the Shepherd Circle organization reached out to us and said, we want to give back to restaurants that have donated to our organization in the past, and we want to give people the opportunity to help hospital workers and purchase meals from your restaurant, you know, so that we could make a little bit of money in this time. And that actually blew up.
Exponentially.
Yes, we actually had more meals bought than workers were employed at the hospital for that shift, so we had to do multiple deliveries over a couple weeks, and it was such a blessing just to be able to do that, you know, to help.
It's kind of a boomerang effect, you know, where we just, as you know, the Lord loves a cheerful giver, we were blessed, and we decided that people out there are struggling to survive, and we just tried to, we never stopped our tithing, we never stopped our giving, we only increased our giving. And I believe with my whole heart that the Lord, He blesses those who sacrifice. And for us to funnel blessings towards people who need them in different ways, that's something that we will never change and only strive to increase in our relationship.
And now we're in what, phase four, and we're half capacity inside, just about. And ultimately, with online ordering, outside dining, inside dining, we feel like we're back at a normal rate, just a little bit different.
God always has a purpose for what may come to your front doorstep. I would ask that this restaurant would be a mission field for the gospel, that people would see Christ in me, Christ in my wife, and ask questions and want what, you know, has been so freely given to us, we would love to share it with other people.
Amen. Well, hey, church, it's good to be here with you in the house of the Lord. As we prepare our hearts for service, let's turn our gaze upon Christ. Let's turn our affections upon Him. For worthy is a Lamb who was slain to receive power and might and glory and honor and blessing. So in this moment, wherever you are, let's stand and sing and give to God the glory He deserves.
We want to give You pure exaltation. So open the heavens. Receive what is Yours, Jesus. Receive what is Yours. Worthy are You. Jesus, evermore we worship you.
Our hands together. All the glory is yours. Come on, God of the promise.
God of the promise, God of the future, you see beginning and end. God of the rescue, God of the breakthrough, how great is your faithfulness.
He's not done.
You're not done yet. No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. No, no, no. God in my seeking, God in my dreaming, put a song in my soul. God in the working, oh God, I'm believing, you'll do the impossible, yeah. Cause you're not done yet, no, no, no. No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word won't be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. Oh no, we believe it. You're up to something.
You're up to something right now. You're doing a new thing right now,
yep.
So God, let your glory come down. And don't hold back, don't hold back.
Yes, you're up to something right now, hey. You're doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold. I'm sure of this, and he who began a good work in you is going to be faithful to complete it on the day of Christ Jesus our Lord. This year looks different, but I can promise you one thing. God is still in the business of taking people from death to life, and we're going to hear testimony of that through baptism right now.
Hey Harvest, we are excited that we get to celebrate Annette Yandel's baptism. And she brought a small cheering section with her that are socially distanced throughout our sanctuary. Family and friends, are you all out there? They are out there. They are out there strong. Annette, tell us a little bit about your spiritual journey and a little bit about your background.
Yeah, so I didn't grow up in a very religious home. I knew there was a God, but I didn't know what it meant to be a Christian. And then my now fiance, he introduced me to Harvest, and that's when my journey began. Before Christ, I was a mess. I didn't I was lonely, I felt like I was unworthy, and I was just angry at the world because my dad passed away at 14, so I just didn't get why God would take someone so special out of my life, so I just felt like I couldn't be loved by anyone.
And you kept coming, you kept learning. I know you got involved in a small group here as well. Austin and you just got engaged recently. Tell us when you made that commitment to say you really wanted to go all in and trust Christ.
Yeah, so it took a little while. There were times where Christ I could feel was pulling me in, but I was ignoring him. And then there was one event where he presented himself and basically was like, I gave you all this and that. I can take it away so easily. And it was actually the Tim Tebow night in November last year that I accepted or surrendered to follow Jesus and accept him as my Lord and Savior.
You will never regret that decision. And why do you want to be baptized today?
I want to be baptized just to show that I trust fully in the Lord and that I love him and that he is my Heavenly Father.
Well, you've got, Beth and I have enjoyed getting to know you and Austin, and I know that God's using you already and he's going to continue to use you, but we're proud of you for making that surrendering and saying, Lord, I give my life to you. I want you to make it personal by repeating a good confession after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
My Lord and Savior.
My Lord and Savior.
Annette Yandel, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
This gospel Well, it is so good to worship the Lord together, isn't it? My name's Tommy Kreitz. I get to serve as the co-campus pastor of our Elgin campus, and also I oversee Harvest students on all of our campuses. And I just want to welcome you to Harvest Bible Chapel online. And listen, if you're new, welcome. We're so glad that you're with us today, and we would love to know that you're here. And so would you check in? Anyone who's hearing this right now, please check in right at the top of the screen, right above the chat. There's a button that says check in. You could do it there, or there's a link in the chat. You can click on that. It just lets us know that you're here. And so would you let us know you're here? We love knowing that you're here every single week, and we would love to pray for you this week as well. So thank you so much for doing that. I want to remind you that at the end of our service today, we're going to be taking communion together. And so wherever you are, make sure that you gather the elements that you need for communion at the end of the service. Doesn't matter if it's a cracker and grape juice or maybe a dark beverage and a piece of bread. It's not what you use. It's what it represents. And so we're looking forward to Pastor Dave Stone leading us in communion together at the end of the service. You know, as we continue gathering as a church online, I know many of you are eager to get back to the church building. So are we. And so I want to let you know that this week, our leaders are going to be sending out an update. And so make sure that you're watching your email, or you can watch harvestbiblechapel.org for more details coming on that this week. Well, hey, I want to remind you that giving is an act of worship. And here at Harvest, we have four different ways that you can give. There's a slide that's going to be coming up on the screen to show you how exactly you can do that. And listen, sometimes I feel this way, maybe you feel this way. It's not always the most exciting way to serve the Lord. But can I remind you of what Matthew 6:21 says? It says that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And I am so thankful that we get to worship God, not only in singing, but through giving and through so many other areas of our life. And so let's do that now. Let's give thankfully to the Lord as we worship him today. Would you pray with me? God, we are so excited to meet with you. We love lifting your name high. We love worshiping your name, and we love hearing from you through your word. And so, Lord, we pray right now that you would help us to lean forward today, lean forward in our hearts and lean forward in our minds. Would we hear the truth of your word? And Lord, would we not only hear it and listen to it, but Lord, would it change us? Would it transform us? Would it impact us? Would we not leave the same way that we came? Lord, you are so faithful to do exactly that. We need you, Lord. Help us now as we worship you, Lord, as we hear from you. And Lord, give us thankful and grateful hearts as we give back to you. You are so worthy of our praise and our worship. We love you, Lord, and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, go ahead and grab your Bibles and prepare your hearts to hear from God's word as the worship team sings over us.
In the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death.
Yes!
And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old, it shall not kneel and shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected. Yeah.
Jesus, God, you alone are worthy of all praise, all honor that we could possibly give, God. Only you are worthy. Lord, this world needs you more than ever, Lord. The world needs the gospel of Jesus Christ, Lord. Would you use your church to bring that message, to bring souls from death to life, Lord? Would you draw near to people, Lord, in this time of uncertainty, in this time where we feel like we have no control, God? We know that you are in control. Lord, would you be with us during this message? God, would you open our hearts to receive your word today? In your holy and powerful name we pray.
Well, hello, Harvest. I am excited that I get the opportunity to be back in the worship center and get to preach here. I know it's been a strange stretch. It's been a long stretch. I commend you for your patience and your persistence and your perseverance, and one step at a time, and eventually we're going to be back at all the campuses, but right now I think we're doing what we need to be doing. As Tommy mentioned, we're going to be leaning into a passage that's filled with tradition and meaning, and we're going to be taking communion at the end of our time together, at the end of this sermon. So I know some of you have already gotten those items and those emblems ready in your own home or wherever it is that you might be watching this. But just utilize whatever you have available for what we hope will be a very meaningful time with the Lord. Now, where we live in Kentucky, we've had several weeks during the COVID crisis where we've had worship in our home with our neighbors coming over. And on one Sunday, my wife Beth had put some grape juice on some several half-filled Dixie cups, and we didn't have any bread in the house, but she had some oyster crackers, you know, oyster crackers like you put in a bowl of soup. So she had placed some snacks at the other end of the counter, but one of our neighbors, Doug, as he came walking in, he saw the oyster crackers, and he immediately said, "Oh, I love oyster crackers." And he started to grab a handful, and my wife and his wife said, "No, no, no, that's communion." And so, you know, we stopped him, but that has now become the standing joke every time we have our cul-de-sac worship service. When he walks in, everyone says, "Guard the communion." And we just try to watch out for it, right? So use whatever you have, and the Lord knows what they represent. Your neighbor Doug might not know, but the Lord knows, right? Well, last week, I appreciated Dave Learned's solid teaching that he gave to us as he talked about the anointing of Jesus and talked about Judas making a deal with the chief priests. And there was a line that Dave said that really stuck with me. He said, "Judas loved coins more than he loved Christ." And I just was hit by that. And I had to do some own personal inventory in my own life. Do I love Christ more than anything else in this world? Well, we pick up the account in Mark chapter 14. If you want to turn and just kind of hold on to Mark chapter 14, we're going to pick it up in verse 12. It's Thursday. This is the day that traditionally the Jewish people will sacrifice a lamb, and the Jewish families will celebrate the Passover. So look in your Bible with me at Mark 14, verse 12. "And on the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him," meaning Jesus, "Where will you have us go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" Now, it's important that you understand the background surrounding this Passover feast that the Jewish people at that time had been having for, I guess it'd been almost 1,500 years. What was the Passover meal? Well, this may be new for some of you, and it might be a refresher for others of you. But Passover was an annual meal that commemorates a defining moment in the history of Israel. It began back when Egypt had the Israelites serving as their slaves. And Moses spoke on behalf of God, and God brought down different plagues to try and change Pharaoh's mind. And you can read about them in Exodus chapters 7 through 12. And the word Exodus, it means exiting. because thanks to God's intervention, the Israelites could exit Egypt and walk out of slavery and into freedom. And the tenth and the final plague is when and where the term Passover originates. The final plague would be the one that got Pharaoh's attention, and it caused him to allow the Israelite slaves to leave and to have their freedom. It says over in Exodus chapter 11, verses 4 and 5, "Thus says the Lord, about midnight I will go out in the midst of Egypt, and every firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die." This final plague would bring down divine justice on the Egyptians and also even on the Jewish people who had been chosen by God if they didn't do what the Lord commanded. But there was one way out. God commands Moses to instruct all of the Israelites, all of the Jewish people, to put the blood of a lamb above their doors so that the Spirit of the Lord, as it would come, would pass over their homes and God would not take their firstborn son. Now, this was just a simple, very meaningful expression. This was a clear expression of their obedience that they had unto God. And that simple act of obedience would spare them immense pain and suffering. I like the way pastor and author Tim Keller puts it. He says, "In every home in Egypt, of the Jews and Egyptians alike, someone would die under the wrath of justice. The only way for your family to escape was to put your faith in God's sacrificial provision. Namely, you had to slay a lamb and put the blood on the door as a sign of your faith in God. In every home that night, there would be either a dead child or a dead lamb." What a sobering thought. God's justice would fall on your family, or you would take shelter under the substitute, under the blood of the Lamb. And everything happened just as God said that it would. And finally, this plague, this powerful act of God, got Pharaoh's attention and momentarily softened his heart. Well, at least long enough for Pharaoh to allow the Israelites to stop serving as slaves and to leave Egypt and begin their exodus, all because the blood of the Lamb caused the angel of death to pass over them, thus the name Passover. And so each spring, the Jewish people still remember and thank God for how he passed over and spared their firstborn son and took them out of slavery. And for the Jews who have become Christians, who have accepted that Jesus is the promised Messiah, that they remember and they thank God for the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, who purchased their eternal freedom. And I just wanted to underscore for you that the Passover is a really big deal for the Jewish people. So now, let's jump ahead 1,500 years. Let's land right back in our text in Mark chapter 14. Remember, it's Thursday. The Passover feast is that night. The disciples and Jesus are going to celebrate it together. But this is going to take some quick planning for a bunch of men to pull off this Passover meal when they are away from their wives and away from their families. We'll pick it back up in Mark chapter 14 and verse 13. It says, Jesus sent two of his disciples. We'll stop right there. Luke's gospel is written by a detailed doctor. And Luke adds in Luke 22, verse 8, the specifics of who the two disciples were. They were Peter and John. We pick it back up. "And he sent two of his disciples and said to them, 'Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, the teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. There, prepare for us.'" And so that's what they did. They went and they got ready and they did everything just as Jesus said. And in this passage, Jesus is going to verbalize three significant actions, and he's going to look into the future. He Here's the first action that he verbalizes. Jesus divinely orchestrates the setting of the Passover meal. Now, this sounds an awful lot like it did back in Mark chapter 11 when we were in that chapter, when right before the triumphal entry, Jesus sends two disciples to an area where he hasn't been, and he tells them where they can find a donkey that's never been ridden before. And the donkey is there just as Jesus predicts. And now in Mark chapter 14, some 4 days after the triumphal entry, Jesus is about to display his divine foreknowledge again. And so the disciples start following, Peter and John start following this man who they find in Jerusalem who is carrying a water jar. He stood out because the men didn't carry the water jar. Usually it was the woman. And so they saw this guy, and that must be the one Jesus wants us to follow. We look back in our Bibles at verse 16, and it says, "And the disciples set out and went to the city and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover." So, water jar man unknowingly leads them to a home where they then speak with the master, and he has a room ready for them. Sometimes we refer to this place as the upper room. Matthew chapter 26, verse 19 tells us the disciples worked together and that they prepared the Passover meal. Now, I'm not sure that I've ever thought about this ragtag team of fishermen and a tax collector and a variety of others coming together to cook and prepare this important meal together. It reminds me of a story about Helen Hayes. Helen Hayes was a famous actress back a number of years ago. And in her autobiography, she wrote about the time that she cooked her very first Thanksgiving turkey. And she said to her family, she said, "Before I bring the turkey out here to the table," she said, "let's just decide right here and now that if the turkey doesn't taste good, if it's not good, don't say a word. We'll just all get up from the table and we'll go to a restaurant to eat." And a few minutes later, when she brought the turkey out from the kitchen, she found her husband and son sitting at the table with their winter coats and their hats already on. Well, we all have our different gifts, right? But the Bible says the disciples worked together, and Peter and John trusted Christ to let a stranger unknowingly lead them to where it was that Jesus wanted to observe the Passover. Jesus is not showing off. He's simply validating his sovereignty. Here's the second significant action that Christ verbalizes in this passage. Jesus clearly predicts his own betrayal by a friend. We pick it up in Mark chapter 14, verses 17 and 18. "And when it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they were reclining at the table and eating, Jesus said, 'Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.'" Now, this had to be painful for Jesus. Here we're given a peek into Jesus' human nature. He's pulling back the curtain and he is revealing his pain and grief. And when you have poured 3 years of your life up close and personal and given people a front row seat to your deity, to your love, to your authority, and yet you are about to be stabbed in the back by a friend, it hurts. It wounds you deeply. And now, with this statement, by predicting his betrayal from within his own inner circle, Jesus is going the extra mile, and he's giving one final chance for Judas not to go through with it. But the immediate response of the disciples may surprise you. I've got to tell you, it surprised me. Very first time I read this, I'm like, this doesn't make sense. Here's what the next verse says in verse 19. "They began to be sorrowful and to say to him one after another, 'Is it I? Is it I?'" Now, the disciples each know the truth, that truth is the only thing that comes out of Jesus' mouth. So they don't question that it is actually going to happen and come to be. But isn't it strange that their first response isn't for all heads to turn and stare at Judas? That's what I thought would have happened. I would have thought that as soon as he said, one of you is going to betray me, everybody would have said, uh-huh, he's right there. Look at his eyebrow. You know, look at how sinister his eyes look. Look at all these different things. No, that's not what they say. Instead, they look inward. They say, is it me? Lord, it's not me, is it? Am I going to be the one that does that? Evidently, he was such a good actor, Judas, that he disguised his greed so well that the disciples each thought they themselves were a more likely candidate than Judas. And they each look and they think that somehow they might be capable of doing the unimaginable. And given the right circumstances, we each realize that we are capable of making extremely poor and disappointing choices to our Lord. Verse 20 continues, and Jesus is speaking. He says, it is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born. Jesus isn't holding back. He is appealing to Judas on several different levels, from friendship all the way to fear. But Judas' heart has been hardened, and he's been listening to Satan's voice more than the voice of Jesus. Joseph Parker was the preacher of the City Temple Church in London, England, for a number of years. He was once asked, why did Jesus choose Judas as a disciple? He knew Judas would betray him. And I love what Pastor Parker replied. He said, I admit that's a mystery, but there's a greater mystery. He said, why would Jesus choose me? And that is a greater mystery. Because it wasn't just Judas' sin that sent Jesus to the cross. It was our sins too. Martin Luther put it aptly when he said, we carry the nails in our pockets. It's a mystery that Jesus chose any of us, but he did, and he does. And no one else would do that. No one else would establish a spiritual kingdom and invite people who at times are anything but spiritual to be a part of it. No one would do that. Only Jesus. Just Jesus. Now remember where we are here in Mark chapter 14. Remember the setting that this conversation, where it's happening. It's while the Passover meal is taking place. And Jesus was leading the disciples through the four sections of this significant meal. And when the Jewish people experienced this meal, they passed on lessons to their families. Why the bitter herbs? Well, it represents slavery. We were enslaved at that time. Why the unleavened bread? It represents purity. Why would we have to eat the meal all dressed up as if we are ready to go somewhere? Because the Israelites needed to be ready to flee in a hurry before Pharaoh would change his mind if he did let them go. You see, there were lessons that were being taught. This was a teaching time. And we're about to come to a point in this passage where, for the very first time, communion will be taken and the Lord's Supper will be instituted. And this will be a new teaching time, and it will become a fulfillment and an amplification of the typical Passover meal. And so here's the third action in the future that Jesus is going to verbalize. It's this: Jesus introduces a new covenant going forward. And Jesus introduces this in a rather familiar setting. Right in the middle of the Passover meal, Jesus chooses this time, the day before his death, as the setting for this new meal. Well, why? Well, it's because he is going to shift the focus of the Passover onto himself. You say, well, that sounds kind of extreme. That sounds kind of narcissistic. That sounds kind of arrogant. Well, not at all. He is the fulfillment of the Old Testament phrase that says, without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sin. And at the Last Supper, when Jesus institutes the Lord's Supper, what he is doing is shifting the focus from the blood of one lamb to another. He just happens to be the other lamb. How was it that John the Baptist described Jesus in John chapter 1, verse 29? The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And the symbolism and the process of the Passover points to Jesus all throughout the meal. And yet it began centuries before Jesus was even born. Look at verse 22. And as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." So during the Passover meal, there was a blessing of the bread. This was the section of the meal when they remembered the manna, the bread that God provided on a daily basis for the Israelites for all of those years on their exit from slavery and on their way to the promised land. And so when Jesus takes the bread and he says, "This is my body," we understand this to be a metaphor. And just as in other places in the Gospels, when Jesus says, "I am the vine," well, we don't think that he means literally that he is a green, leafy, curvy branch. Or when he says, "I am the door," that he is a literal 3-foot by 7-foot piece of wood with a handle attached. No, these are representative symbols helping us to more easily understand and relate to what's taking place. And symbols have always been important all throughout the Bible. Think about a rainbow. A rainbow in the sky reminds us of God's promise that he will never again destroy the earth with a flood. It's a symbol. Baptism. Baptism expresses humble obedience, and it's a visual picture of the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus. The Bible says that in baptism you are clothed with Christ. And earlier in the worship service, when we witnessed Annette's baptism, we were seeing an outward expression of an inward commitment. It's a powerful symbol. And going forward from this day, Jesus has now introduced a brand new symbol. And Passover would take the form of communion or the Lord's Supper. It would become an ongoing observance of communion and would take the form of regularly remembering the blood of the Lamb that saved us from our sin. And the symbolism would become more obvious to the disciples in a dozen or so hours when they would see the Lamb of God bleeding from a scourging, and seeing him crucified on a cross. And I'm trying to convey for you somehow just how radical of a change this would be to the typical Passover celebration. This isn't a subtle change. This isn't Jesus making just a little tweak or a minor adjustment. This would be like a pastor or an evangelist announcing at the beginning of December that from now on, people are no longer to think of Jesus and his birth when they celebrate Christmas. And the pastor goes on to say, "From now on, people are to think of me as God's greatest gift to the world. Jesus is not the reason for the season. I am." Now, if we heard a pastor saying something like that, we'd write him off and we would say that he's crazy or he is delirious or he's really out there. But let's say that that particular pastor had always been wise and trustworthy and sensible. Well, that might cause us to press pause and then to dig deeper and examine the evidence. And if the disciples will just wait for the weekend to end, there's going to be plenty of evidence from Friday to Sunday. Now, it takes a lot of confidence and nerve to completely change the imagery of a meaningful meal that has occurred for more than a millennium. And on a human level, this would be outrageous to even think about, unless, of course, he indeed is the Messiah. And in that case, it would just reveal a much bigger plan. And it would display just how unconditional is the love that God has for us. That on the next day, he would have his one and only son serve as a substitutionary lamb whose blood would take away the sin of the world. To be more specific, to take away your sin, to take away my sin. And from this day on, for those who would follow Jesus, when the church would be instituted, He would be the focus of this meal. And later in Acts chapter 2 and in Acts chapter 20, verse 7, we'll learn that communion, this Jesus Passover, would become an ongoing staple for Christ followers when they would worship together. Jesus would be the focus of this simple, brief, meaningful meal of eating and drinking. Look in your Bible at verse 23. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. Now, notice a couple of things here. First of all, Jesus takes one cup, prays over it, and then passes it around for each of them to drink from it. So clearly, there was no COVID pandemic at the time in that year. This would not happen in our season of our lives in 2020. We would not pass a cup for everyone. But secondly, notice this, that they took it individually, but also collectively. They passed it around. Each of them drink from it. So clearly what's taking place is this is a unifying experience. And even when we are spread out and separated due to a pandemic, even when the church is separated from one another, when we take communion, it is a unifying experience. Even when we are in different living rooms, in different locations, we are united together as Christ followers, as the body of Christ. And when we drink, we remember his death and his burial and his resurrection. Think of it this way. The world drinks to forget. The Christian drinks to remember. And for a minute, it causes our minds to memorialize what our Master and Messiah did for us at Calvary. And through the institution of this new Passover, he is making a promise. He is making a new covenant. Look in your Bible at verse 24. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." Now, this is not a contract that is filled with endless pages of, hey, if you do this, then I'll do that. No, it's different. This is a covenant. This is not a contract. It's a promise. It's a meshing together. It's a bringing together of us with God. It's a partnership. Back in Exodus chapter 24, verses 5 and 6, when God made the covenant of the law with the Jewish people, it was the blood of bulls that was used to institute it. But here, with this new covenant going forward, it wouldn't be the blood of some animal to seal this promise. Jesus says in Mark 14, it will be my blood. You see the difference? Most kings send their subjects out to die on their behalf, but our king went out and died on behalf of his subjects, and he willingly chose to become a suffering king for us. That's why he is the King of Kings. That's why he is the Lord of Lords. And when you drink the cup of communion, remember that Jesus didn't spill his blood on our behalf. He intentionally shed his blood. You see, he could have avoided the cross. When you spill something, it's an accident. The cross was no accident. This new covenant that Jesus is instituting was no accident. We watched a God at Work video at the start of this service, and I loved when Dave Perlick said, God always has a purpose. And he has a purpose here in Mark 14. Before the foundation of the world was laid, the cross was God's plan for his one and only Son. And here in Mark 14, he says, this is my blood of the covenant that seals the promise. It isn't spilled. Jesus says, it is poured out for many. He poured it out for you. And even though we didn't deserve a pardon for our punishment, he gave it to us anyway. We just have to put our trust in him. We just have to swallow our pride and get off of the throne and put him where he belongs. Verse 25. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. The Lord's Supper isn't a time of just looking back. The Lord's Supper is also a time of looking forward with hope, looking forward to that day when believers will share with Jesus the new wine and the new food at the wedding feast of the Lamb. And please understand this. Communion allows us a time of commemoration, of examination, and participation. Remember those three words in a few minutes when those of you who are followers of Christ will take communion. The word, commemoration, remember that. It's a memorial where we pause for a few minutes to remember the perfect sacrifice of Jesus. And it's a time of examination where we look inward and we confess our sins. This is not a general sweeping statement of, oh, forgive me my sins. Instead, it is a personal, specific coming clean and specifically repenting and asking God to cover over our sins through the blood of Jesus Christ. And it's a time of participation. As the body of Christ, we unite through this Jesus Passover meal. We are participating in his life and through his death and his resurrection, realizing that the blood of the Lamb can change our eternal destiny. Our suffering King is our sovereign King who can look into the future. But I'm here to tell you that Jesus' knowledge and power and love wasn't just limited to when he walked the earth. You see, more importantly, Jesus is just as interested and involved in the details of your life as he was the disciples. And he invites you into a personal relationship with him because he cares about you and because he loves you. And the blood of the Lamb can change everything. It can wipe your slate of sin completely clean before the Lord. Back in the late 1800s in Newark, Ohio, there was a man by the name of Neil Johnston. And Neil Johnston was around 25 years old at the time. He was married, he had a little baby. He was known as a good man with a bad temper. And one day he got in an argument with his neighbor over a property line, and that line dispute between the two got so out of hand that it turned into a fist fight, and things quickly went downhill from there, and it ended with Johnston killing his neighbor. He was sentenced to life imprisonment at the Ohio State Penitentiary, and that was back when life imprisonment actually meant for life. But over the years, Johnston gained the respect of the inmates that he was there with, and also from those who worked at the prison. And they had an unusual custom back then. Each year at Christmas time, it was a custom of the state of Ohio for the governor of the state to release one prisoner each year upon the recommendation of the warden. Of course, those who were in for life were never considered because they were in for a serious crime. But one Christmas morning, nearly 12 years after the time of the murder, all of the inmates quietly filed into the room in silence on that Christmas morning, awaiting the anticipated announcement by the warden of who would be freed and pardoned. And after a moment, the silence was broken when the warden said, "Neil Johnston." There was silence. He said, "Neil Johnston, would you come forward?" Still nothing. And then you could hear the quiet sobs of an inmate, and the warden began walking down through the rows of the inmates, and finally he came to where Neil Johnston was. He was down on his knees and he was sobbing. He was saying one phrase over and over again under his breath: "There must be some mistake, there must be some mistake." And the warden put his hand on his shoulder and said, "Neil, there is no mistake. The pardon is real." When we look at ourselves and we see our sin, and when we look at Calvary, we see forgiveness. And in disbelief, we look heavenward and we say, "There must be some mistake. There must be some mistake." And our gentle shepherd puts his hand on our shoulders and he says, "There is no mistake. The pardon is real. The pardon is real." Christians believe that the cross made it possible for us to be forgiven of our failures, to be saved out of slavery from sin, to be justified in the eyes of the judge, to be pardoned from our punishment. And at the Last Supper, and then at the cross, Jesus proved that he is interested and involved in the details of your life and mine just as much as he is the disciples. And today, as individuals and as a church, we have the opportunity to take communion, the Lord's Supper. And Vertical is going to play a song for the next 3 or 4 minutes. This is a time for you to just, you can go right now if you need to get your bread, to get your juice, whatever you're going to use. Some items that can represent Jesus' body and his blood that he poured out for you. And during that song that's going to be played and sung, you can listen, you can sing, you can silently pray to God, commemorate what it is that he did at Calvary, and examine your heart, confess and repent of your sins. This is a very private and a very personal moment. And then before the song ends, when you're ready, when your heart is ready, for those of you who have put your trust in Jesus as your Savior, when you're ready, then you can eat of the bread and you can drink of the juice. Let's pray and take communion. Dear God in heaven, you have the ability to look into the future, to know what we need and when we need it. You always have a purpose. And you knew that we would need a new covenant and that the blood of the Lamb could atone for our sins once and for all. And so as we listen to this song and as we take communion, will you move in our hearts in these moments of commemoration and examination and participation? And may we take of these emblems in a worthy manner. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
I take the bread of life, broken for all my sin. Your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the cup poured out in sacrifice to trade this sinner's end for your new covenant. And alleluia, I'll live my life in remembrance. And alleluia, your promise I won't forget. I'll walk salvation's road with fear and trembling. Your way born as my own, as Christ is formed in me. And alleluia, I'll live my life in remembrance. Alleluia, your promise I won't forget. If ever I should lose my way, if ever I deny your grace, remind me of the price you paid. Alleluia, I'll live in remembrance.
I hope that that was a meaningful time for you. And for some of you, maybe this is kind of new to you, or you're uncertain if you really belong to Jesus, if you really are a Christian. Maybe find yourself in a similar situation to the Israelites back years ago, and you want out of the slavery to sin, the slavery to self, and you want to walk toward freedom in Christ. And you can begin that journey right now. Perhaps you've never made a commitment to Jesus and you find yourself in that situation. And now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. And you've been given a clear, simple instruction to put your trust in the blood of the Lamb. And if you put your trust in the blood of the Lamb, then Jesus says you can reap the benefits of his substitutionary sacrifice. And you can begin that journey by letting us know of that decision, by taking out your mobile device and just texting the word follow to 797979. Just send us that text, follow. A pastor will get in touch with you, someone who would love to encourage you. They would love to pray with you. They'd love to just find out what's on your heart. But thanks so much for worshiping with us today. We're going to do that song, and then we're going to conclude in just a minute. Continue to worship with us.
You've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. You're too thick where I would be. If not for you, if not for you. Oh, you've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. You're too is from the west, so far your grace has carried me, until I see you face to face, until at last I won my race. Remind me you're not finished yet, and alleluia, alleluia.
So good worshiping with you today, and it's been great taking communion together as a church. And what a powerful message from Pastor Dave Stone. Listen, I hope that you have a wonderful week. Thank you so much for joining us online together, and remember this: you are loved.